If we are Team Notorious, we look to create these winning conditions by implementing a push-pull-float strategy. McGregor straight left has variations, but it comes in two distinct flavors. The first one is the Celtic Cross, lightning. There is a second, more violent version of the Celtic Cross, thunder. In past performances, Conor saved the thunder until he had his opponents badly hurt and lined up on a finishing angle. Only after there'd been many lightning strikes did the thunder appear, because too much thunder leads to power outages. If we're Team Diaz, we'll create winning conditions with a three-pronged strategy we can call roll, rough, and rumble. We want Nate Diaz to fight a Nate Diaz fight and play to his unique skills and rugged psychology. Diaz's combat style is an authentic expression of his personality, equal parts ornery and artistry, and you'll truly see it the way he finished Conor last time. Watch the magic. He wants to turn the head, controls the chin, needs the Adam's apple deep in the V to compress both the jugular vein and the carotids. What's the Diaz method to line him up? Punch his melon into the choke. Ha ha, there's only one Nate Diaz, and there's only one Diaz punch choke.
What up, everybody? It's the Sound of Violence podcast. This is Pulver. I'm here again with Chris. What up, dude?
What's up?
Not much. We are back at it once again on Fight Week. We went through our ridiculous Rich Franklin Cyborg Soldier commentary last week, which was straight chaos.
Yeah, it was fun, but in a masochistic way.
Right. It was some painful moments in that one. So we are finally back at it with a regular format. We're going to jump in off the top of the podcast that we've listened to recently that are MMA related. And since we actually don't have any fights to cover, since there was nothing last weekend of note, we will just jump right into our 202 breakdown, because that's going to be huge. There's a ton of fights on there that are worth talking about. So yeah, why don't we get right into format? We will go ahead and talk about our podcast that we listened to this week. I have a whole bunch of them, actually, since everyone's doing a podcast this week, if not multiple ones, from what I've seen. There's just been a ton of content getting pushed out. Most of which are breakdowns and fight-related for this weekend, from what I've seen. Off the top, oh, that's right. The intro, you guys will have heard Robin Black doing his predictions for, or his breakdowns of what Conor and Nate both need to do in the upcoming fight, which is so fucking funny. It's just super ridiculous and over the top.
He basically just breaks the stereotype of boring, traditional analyst, you know, kind of feeling that you get in sports, basically.
Well, he does that, but he also comes up with all his fucking crazy, like, I was clearly a writer at some point lines.
Yeah,
like,
his whole mumbo-jumbo shit that he does with his lingo.
Yeah, his flim-flam.
Yeah, his flim-flam, exactly. Yeah. With the old, like you were telling me, boxing terminology.
Yeah, he is all over the place in that one. He's saying Conor has to use the lightning and the thunder. He's saying Nick Diaz needs
to work Celtic on the Cross.
That's right, the Celtic Cross. Nick Diaz needs to work on his, what was it, the tax slit?
Yeah, and he's like, and not BSIRS.
Yeah, and then he has to fucking, I don't know, go hard or some shit. I wasn't even one of them. It was ridiculous and over the top. He yells a lot of just crazy, insane shit. And I thought it was fucking hilarious. So I added that on the intro because it cracked me up. What are some of the podcasts that you listen to this week off the top?
I'll listen to a handful, but I listen to multiple episodes of some of them. I listen to two different episodes of UFC's Unfiltered.
Which ones?
I listen to the Cody Garbrandt, and the other person they had on there was Benji Madden from Good Charlotte, but I didn't listen to his because I'm just going to be a dick. I just didn't care.
No, that's what I would do.
Okay, so
that's, all it is. I haven't listened to it at all yet.
I
saw Benji Raddick and I was like, nope.
Yeah. So that's why I'll listen to what Cody Gartman had to say. And then the other episode I listened to was Donald Cowboy Cerrone. His is only about 10 minutes long because he was wakeboarding at the time when he called in.
Of course he was, yeah.
But the other person on there, which was really fun to listen to, was the Bob Saget, of all people. That was fantastic.
Bob Saget's a character. He's actually been around the sport for a while because I don't know if it's because of Joe or just because he was into it. But he's been around, like, you would see him in, like, some of the old UFC when they used to just constantly show celebrities every event. Like, I don't know if it was Vince McMahon just 100% influencing the UFC at the time or what, but, like, every event it would be like, oh, why is Carmen Electra sitting there again? Oh, that was back when she was dating Tito, to be fair. But you're like, why is it just cutting to Jenny McCarthy in the crowd every 20 minutes for no reason, like.
Good old fucking early 2000s, late 90s crap. Yeah, and it's like, Bob Saget. Well, that's right. Even before Mike Goldberg. Exactly. Yeah.
Wilder Valderrama.
Yeah. Anthony Kiedis.
Anthony Kiedis. All time, every time. Hey, look, he has a shirt on. It's crazy. Yeah, I know. It's wild. Yeah. His nips aren't showing. What? Fucking, oh my God.
That's my least favorite. Listen to those from them. The other ones, I listen to co-main events. That was fun to listen to.
Yeah, that's the thing about co-main event podcast is, like, it's always just so consistent that, like, I don't know what to say about it other than just, like, it's just good again. It's just great. They talk about great shit.
And then I listen to, you know, Ariel Helwani's MMA Hour. The ones that I listen to, because I know he usually has about, like, 6 to 7 guests on there. I listen to Damian
Maia. MMA Fortnite
I listen to Damian Maia, what he had to say. I enjoyed that. And I listened to part of what Artem Lobov had to say. And
how was that part? I haven't listened to that one yet.
It wasn't bad. He seems like a genuine guy. I mean, he just, he understands, you know, what he has.
He knows he's just a super jobber.
he admits, he's like, yeah, you know, I'm a fighter, you know. He's like, you know, I haven't had the best success in the past, obviously, but it's like a fighter's, it's your job, you know, he just tries to win, you just try to do your job. You know, we all get it. He seems pretty genuine to me.
I'm interested in that fight between him and Diaz.
Chris Avila, right? Yeah, Chris Avila, I think it's Avila. And then I listen to McGregor, of course, who is the man of the hour. He's always fun to listen to, and he seems like, I don't say a good guy, because I don't know him personally, but, he, you know, outside of the fight persona, McGregor seems like a nice guy to me. I don't know. It seems like he just loves to fight. That's what I get out of it when I listen every time.
He seems like he could be a good dude when he's not, like, sounding super coked up all the time.
Yeah.
Because that is kind of his new thing, is just constantly be coked up. Like, I don't know if he's actually coked up or whether he's just, like, fucking loves Monster Energy drinks. That's why he's chucking those cans.
Dude, I think he genuinely just loves Monster. He's just so hyped about Monster.
That's why he started chucking cans at the press conference. Yeah. He's just like, Monster's dope! Here, Nate Diaz!
Pretty much.
Did you see the press
conference? Oh, yeah. I saw that.
We'll get into that. We'll get into that.
Just like fucking Jake Shields being the cocksucker he is, trying to grab that journalist's laptop.
Except I'm pretty sure there's a water bottle behind that laptop that he's actually trying to grab.
Oh, no.
I saw the video, too, and if you look at
I'm sure, yeah.
That would have been the world's shittiest. It was, like, attempted.
I know, but he...
Because he literally, like, leaned, and then the dude, like, leaned, and then it was it.
No, not my MacBook. Fuck you, you know.
But it looked like that was the least, like... full-hearted attempt to actually grab it.
He just,
like,
thought about it.
Seemed like he was reaching for a water bottle or something that was closer, but...
Yeah, if you want, because did you listen to Unfiltered?
Nope, I heard Unfiltered or MMA Hour.
Real quick, I'll just say, with what Cody Garbrandt had to say, he was basically talking about how he likes to give back to his community. He says after every fight, he likes to go back to his to Ohio. I can't remember what part of Ohio he's from. It's definitely a small town. He said it's kind of like a redneck town in a way, but not really, because not really in the South. That's what he called it, right? He says he loves getting back to his community. He goes to his alma mater, his high school. He likes coaching kids there.
That's cool.
I liked enjoying hearing about that. They asked him, of course, about all of his tattoos that he has. Basically, he says tattoos to him are like therapy. He enjoys the pain, apparently, but
That's always such a fucking new metal answer for that.
Yeah.
Like, all right, Fred Durst, take it easy, bitch.
Yeah, take it easy, fucking the Linkin fucking, Park.
I can understand your shitty neck tattoos now. Your fucking,
yeah, because I asked him, too. Matt Serra's like, he's like, a lot of people don't like neck tattoos, but you clearly don't give a fuck since you got one. He's like, yeah, I was like 16, of course, you know. Obviously, you don't give a
great
fuck.
Great decision making, yeah.
But either way, of course, they asked him Dominic Cruz, and of course, his skewed answer was, oh, I think Dominic's jealous of me, kind of thing. You know, whatever. Anyone can interpret it however they want.
Yeah, he wants to fuck Paige like I tried to.
Yeah.
And, it's, you know.
She's with God, bro. So, that ain't happening. That's right. Whatever the fuck it is.
My dick doesn't have God tattooed on it yet, so I can't get at it.
But either way, I mean, he seems like I'm glad he gets back to his community. As far as the whole Dominic Cruz thing, you know, in my opinion, he's going to have to fight TJ Dillashaw before he ever fights Dominic Cruz, because they know they can build that shit up just because of the whole former alpha male betrayal bullshit fucking whatever storyline you want to draw
it'll
with
be,
that.
It'll be interesting.
Or the fact that Garbrandt claims that he knocked out Dillashaw when they... Whatever, I mean, I don't give a fuck. All, but,
everybody claims yeah, everybody dude, every, knocked out everybody
anyways,
in sparring.
Moving on from Garbrandt, I enjoyed that he
that's
likes to get back to
that's
his...
That's how sparring works.
Yeah. Cowboy Cerrone, basically in the 10 minutes that he had... He loves spending money. He doesn't like saving money. Yep. He just
that
loves living
like
the moment.
Every dollar's
right. He loves riding his motorcycles. He loves snowboarding. He loves wakeboarding, surfing, anything that's extreme.
Yeah.
He said skydiving, right? Apparently, when you go skydiving, usually you have to have someone on your back. Oh, not him. He took the crash course and actually was smart enough to pass the first course and was able to do skydiving solo. So good for him.
That's, again, why you should... It's not. When, it's not great when you're a professional athlete and you have fucking can't break yourself. But
yeah,
right, sure.
And
yeah.
When they asked him about the 202, he's just saying Nate's gonna win because of his BJJ. You know, they always ask you on the fly who's gonna win the fight, that kind of thing. He said, if I was Conor McGregor, I would utilize kicks against Nate because why would you want to box with a boxer? Yep. I get that too. Then he just talked about how there's a lot of emotions going on in the octagon. Blah blah blah. Other than that, the other episode I watched, Bob Saget, was interesting at later on because he talked about how it's important to eat healthy and have nice-smelling poo. That's what, according to him.
Yeah, that
he
sounds
says,
like some dumb shit he
would say. According to when it comes to the elections this year, he said that's all bullshit, we're fucked. Basically, we're living in a society that is like the movie The Running Man. So, basically, if you've seen The Running Man with Arnold Schwarzenegger, entertaining movie, I'll leave it at that, obviously, not for the acting, but entertaining as a sci-fi movie. Yes, the way society is built up in a film, I kind of agree. That's kind of how it is now, where it's kind of like we're all on one big fucking TV show, and we're being controlled by some person.
I agree, but if Bob Saget
maybe not that extreme, but
I was gonna say if Bob Saget wasn't 90, he would use the reference Idiocracy.
No, he talked to I was gonna say he talked about how he just turned 60.
Yeah,
I can't believe
he's
still alive.
The oldest person ever. Yeah, and the fucking all his references are from the '80s. Still, when he was still like when he started dealing coke is when he stopped knowing the references.
The one thing I did like about that thing I didn't realize. Do you remember that movie Dirty Work that was with Norm MacDonald and it was Chris Farley's last movie? I didn't even realize Bob Saget directed that. So he kept talking about how there was a rated R version that they had to cut because apparently they wanted to.
Oh, where is that?
I know, right? Because
he
still wants to do a direct.
Ever.
He says the rated R version is apparently there's a scene in the movie, right? Where there's a frat party and the frat boys are being assholes. So Norm MacDonald's character, and I think it's Artie Lang, they go to the frat house and they deliver the frat boys donuts. And the rated R version, it's supposed to be where underneath the donuts, there's like a Polaroid picture printout of a picture of Norm and Artie with like erections and donuts hanging on their erect dicks or something like that.
That's
he says
hilarious.
In the script, he's like, yeah, Norm had 6 donuts and we're going to fuck with Artie and make him only have like 3 or something like that. He's like, oh, but back then in the 90s, that would be considered R. He's like, oh, nowadays it'd be totally just PG-13
because you
just have more underwear
PG-13,
or something like that. But I thought that was kind of interesting.
That's hilarious.
That's all I have for Unfiltered. I mean, I'll let you chime in what you wanted to talk about. Which ones did you listen to? Or what was one of your highlights?
So first one I wanted to talk about was Heavy Hands. Let me see exactly the number. It's their
It was
breakdown.
119 because I had that queued up myself, but... I was an idiot and didn't actually press play.
Yeah, you know what? We will we'll listen to a clip from it on the break, and I will put actually a clip on the break as well, so that way you guys can hear it, but or just a chunk of it. But they just do a fantastic breakdown. They're always fantastic. They actually had the pod, the breakdown that we talked about last week, where they talked about managing range and being a shorter fighter that is trying to actually come in and, like, the right way to be a shorter fighter, essentially. How it's better to, like, stand and counter than try and chase people or let people chase you. You just kind of have to
pull. Yeah, because you don't want that reach disadvantage, obviously.
You know, right, so you basically, they talk a lot about how you have to pull and then just throw hard. And they do a lot of interesting talk about the differences between what Connor has to do and what Nate has to do. Talk a lot about mostly Connor. I mean, like everybody has been, just because he's the biggest X factor in this whole situation. Talk a ton about how they think Connor needs to really work the kicking game more and basically try to land something significant somewhere. From most of the breakdowns I've heard, I have not been hearing a lot of good things about people saying Connor will do well if he goes late. Like, from pretty much what everybody's saying, it's like, listen, yeah, we've never even seen him go past three rounds.
That's I was going to say, everything I heard today was, can Connor even go five rounds with someone with as good cardio as, you know, Nate Diaz? And that's really going to be the key. Is Connor going to keep his game plan where he tries to swing hard in the beginning rounds? Or is he going to play it smart and try to be a cardio guy? You know what I mean?
Yeah, it also depends on... they're also in this podcast, they talked to Connor and Pat Wyman talked a ton about what Nate has to do in terms of just establishing his left hand and essentially just constantly keeping the pressure. They mentioned in the first fight that at one point there was a uppercut that was landed in the second. You could visibly see Nate afterwards start taunting Connor because he felt power on that uppercut, and they started, which is actually the clip that we just played. Was that one
like counter uppercut or whatever bullshit Connor kept talking about in his training camp, or was like, oh, I'm a faint with my right and just go with like a quick uppercut.
He did land that,
and then that's when Nate like goes wide with his hands and like puts his guard down and starts talking shit.
Well, and Pat Wyman did some stat breakdowns on the podcast about that. He said he watched, and after that, these numbers aren't going to be right, but luckily we just played it a second ago. But essentially, he said Connor, or after that, Nate started throwing something around the range of like 30. Sorry, you guys, I should say out loud, I had an edible before this and it's just starting to kick in. So that's why you're hearing a lot of mumbling from me. I'm trying to keep up with what I remember. But Pat Wyman was saying that I think Nate threw about 30 strikes in the minute following that exchange, whereas normally he ranges about 15 to 20.
Oh, shit.
And then after that, that was when Nate, about a minute later is when Nate landed that huge 1-2, and then the last 30 seconds, or the next 30 seconds after that, Nate threw another 30 or so strikes, 25, 30 strikes. So basically, Nate just started pouring it on, as he felt Connor gas. It's just interesting to hear what they think Connor needs to do. They give Connor a ton of credit for being crazy dynamic and just like the thought that he might be special enough to be able to adapt to such crazy diversity.
I mean, yeah, I was gonna say, I don't want to chime in now because we'll get into it when we do the card breakdown, but right. I'll leave it at that, but I see where they're coming from. That's all I'll say now.
Well, they say that, and they also say off the top that Connor is by definition fighting one of his worst style matchups.
Oh, of course.
At 100%.
Yeah, like, most definitely.
Because his whole style is the best against standard moving right-handed pressure fighter.
Yeah, because he never usually fights other southpaws like himself, right? Isn't it? Yeah, it's just orthodox guys.
Right, where it's like standard moving right-handed dudes that can that have a way more, like Aldo is a perfect
example. That will eat the left more often, right?
Right, yeah. And he's only fought one left-handed fighter, which was Dustin Poirier, and that was only about a minute and a half.
Yeah.
So they talk about, we haven't really seen a lot of him dealing with left-handed fighters. They also say they think RDA would have done really fucking well against Connor, which I've been seeing a shitload of threads saying the contrary on the Underground. I don't know if Reddit MMA's been
smarter. Wait. They said RDA would have done well, or he would have
murdered Connor.
But you said contrary, so you think Connor would have done well against RDA? Or do you mean you agree?
I agree.
What sorry, it's because you said on the contrary on Underground, because that's what you just said.
Oh, the Underground is always saying... The Underground's been posting a bunch of articles saying...
Connor would have done well, Connor I'm sure. Connor would have
fucking yeah. murdered...
I know what you mean, because I know there's no way in fuck you would think Connor would murder
no,
Artie.
I no,
know
I yeah. was saying before yeah, that fight, I can't wait to make so much money on Artie.
yeah, yeah, no.
Just like I made
me
on Nate Diaz
me included,
tape,
yeah,
parlay.
Me included. Don't get me
Speaking
wrong.
Speaking of which, my Tyrone Woodley and Nate Diaz parlay
Wait, did you say Tyrone?
Tyron. Did I say Tyron?
I'm fucking
fuck
with you, dude. I'm fucking with you. I really don't give a shit.
I'm Matt Sarah. Fuck off.
More like Wonderboy Tyron.
There's a podcast for Tyron.
No, it's all good.
That's hilarious. Yeah, so that was Heavy Hands. It's fucking fantastic. There's about four different clips I wanted to use throughout this podcast because they were all just so dope. And they have such interesting takes on that, so I absolutely recommend checking that out. And, you know, me and Chris will actually listen. You know what? We'll do heavy hands for two of the breaks. So, for the next break, we will do another heavy hands clip, and then me and Chris will comment on it afterwards. So, let's go ahead, and what do you have up next? Anything else you listen to? Oh, wait. Also, we should say, this segment of the podcast, sponsored by Left Hand Brewing Company, is Oktoberfest. It's pretty fucking dank.
Yeah, this is awesome. What's it, excuse my faux German accent, a Marzen lager.
Yeah, Marzen.
This is the style.
Yeah. Oh, also, the segment of the podcast is sponsored by Korova White Cheddar Weed Popcorn. It's fucking medical
it
cannabis.
It tastes just absolutely like weed.
That's right.
But it's sprinkled with white cheddar.
It's about 300 milligrams in a bag. It's like $20. It was a good deal, and I had maybe a third of it, and I'm sounding dumb. So, alright, go ahead. What were we talking about?
Oh, yeah, what'd you listen to? Oh, by the way, just shout out, this is, I'm going to get the bad news out of the way early. Unfortunately, yeah. Chael Sonnen, as
shout
we know,
out is a
Chael,
way
the legendary Chael P. Sonnen, you know, hailing from Westland, Oregon,
can
the American
shout
gangster.
Out an R.I.P.?
In what?
Can you shout out an R.I.P.? Because I just realized you started that with shout out.
Oh, yeah. Okay, well, okay. Well, anyways, I don't want to say shout out, but unfortunately, we had some unfortunate... Yeah. We had some unfortunate news in the MMA community. Chael Sonnen, he had the birth of his daughter, but unfortunately, his daughter passed away shortly after birth. She was born, I believe, 9 to 10 weeks premature. I know there's a lot of conflictions with that. You know, with just the health of a baby. Myself, I was born 8 weeks premature, and I was in the hospital for 3 months, so I know how it is. You basically have to fight for your life, and I'm very, you know, my thoughts and prayers go out to Chael Sonnen and his family. Very unfortunate news. Just wanted to just kind of just let
yeah,
that out there.
That's super bummer, for sure. Actually, you know what? I'll transition into something MMA-related on that. Well, somewhat MMA-related. I saw a lot of people complaining on the Underground... about Ariel breaking that story.
Really? Oh, okay. Because
Ariel broke that story.
Oh, wow.
And people were complaining on the Underground. They're like, fucking Ariel has to be the first breaking everything.
Well, it's just...
What do you think?
I mean, I guess people complain about whatever. I mean
it's,
to
it
me,
is
new,
a weird one to break.
I mean,
but I bet you he probably had, like, chills. He gave him the go-ahead on it.
So I'm
like,
sure, yeah. I mean, in my opinion, news is news. Well, whoever wants to break news is news. Whether it's
you know Ariel
it's good
was
news
like,
or bad
is this
news.
Off the record or on the record at
yeah.
some point?
No, I know.
You know he got the news from Chael.
Yeah, I mean, I know he's a good journalist. He has his integrity. He wants to always be, I feel like he's a true, we journalists call it being a gatekeeper to the public, whatever the fuck you want to call it, you know, filtering out good and bad news, right? So yeah, I'm sure, like you were just saying, he got the go-ahead from Chael. It's terrible news. No one ever wants to have to experience losing, you know, a child. That's not good. But anyways, yeah, sorry guys for the shitty news. We just want to get that out of the way. And just hope all the good vibes are sent to Chael Sonnen and his family. So...
Yep, absolutely. So why don't we go ahead and we will transition next into what fucking podcast do I have lined up that's going to be a weird transition to this? Tyron Woodley, or wait, hold on. I feel like I had a different one.
I was going to say, I was going to listen to episode 33, you know, where he talks. I remember someone told me, or I read... his new episode where he talks about his reflection against
Conor
McGregor, right?
Yeah.
Calling him out or just talking shit. No, not calling him, but just talking shit on him, right? It
was because Connor said the thing about, oh, nobody knows who the fuck...
Eddie Woodley Alvarez, and yeah. Eddie are. Yeah, they're all bums. Fight
each other. Yeah, they're bums. He's like, fucking, I'm a bum. You fought fucking nobody. I fought fucking in Strikeforce. I fought Jake Shark fucking Shields. I fought goddamn Carlos Condit. I fought, like... And Eddie Alvarez, he went on for like 10 minutes about how all the people Eddie's fought. He's like, you don't know anything about the sport. Have you ever seen Eddie Alvarez and Michael Chandler fight ever? Like, you're out of your fucking mind.
Yeah, if you think about it, I think like the only thing Connor could just try to feel is, oh, you're a bum. You fucking pleaded and begged to UFC brass for 18 months, blah, blah. Whatever the fuck someone will try to... Yeah, whatever. You
Connor
know.
Likes to talk, but Connor does not want to fight fucking Woodley. I'll tell you that well, right no, now. Woodley talked about that, too. He's like, dude, yeah, no. You don't want to fight me. Like, I don't hit like these other little fucking... Yeah, no. I don't hit like Nate Diaz hits. Like, I fucking hit different than all these little dudes you're training with.
Yeah, Woodley's
with.
So stocky, he could fucking Woodley drop to 180. He'd go up to 185. Yeah, he's like, be tiny in 185, but he could do it.
Well, he sees like I just knocked Robbie DeLauer the fuck out. Like, you didn't want any part of Robbie DeLauer. You definitely don't want any. Plus, I could wrestle. There's a lot of that.
Yeah, he so would just like, I would just wrestle on, the shit yeah, out of McGregor.
He's like, I would just sit on you for four rounds and then finish you. Like,
exactly.
It's pretty funny.
And I was gonna say the only other thing I remember I heard it was I don't want to say anti Woodley, but I remember they asked Nate Diaz what are your thoughts on it was just on UFC Embedded. His opinion on Woodley wanting to fight GSP was that it was silly and that no fight should ever be made between text messages and friends.
Oh, yeah. I did kind of like that, though,
because, I mean, in the article, I know we mentioned the article I wrote, I'm on both sides of the fence. I like that you should be able to call for money fights. Everyone deserves to get paid. However, you should also just fight whoever's the best, man. You know what I mean?
For
if
sure.
If you really want to prove you're the best. And
Nate doesn't want to prove he's the best. Nate wants fucking paper.
Oh, he wants paper. I get that.
And he always says that shit. He's like,
I kind of almost legitimately, like, do you legitimately believe if someone told you Nate Diaz does not give a shit about the 155 belt?
Him and his brother both.
They absolutely don't. Yeah, they don't give a shit.
He said so recently. Yeah. He's like, I don't care about the belt. Like,
they don't.
I'm trying to make money. I'm not about that, like, weird fucking... Like chasing the weird little toy shit.
You already know. Even if he like say he became champion,
it's hard to recreate Nate Diaz.
Yeah. He'd be like this. He'd be like this. He'd be like, I mean, the belt's cool, I guess, but
why
like,
does he sound like Carmen?
I mean, whatever. I can't really do a lisp of myself. So that probably.
I don't think he has a lisp.
Maybe it's not a lisp. Yeah, someone said. I don't know. Anyways, I won't sell him. But basically, if he had to say, he wouldn't give a shit about the belt. You know, because what? If he was a champion, of course he'd defend it, because it's probably, you know, part of what he would do with
the
schedule.
Well, yeah, and
if
somebody would get him fucking paid was champ, he would fight that dude.
I mean, yeah.
But it's like how Nate would fight, or how Nick fought GSP, because GSP is the fucking money fight. Like,
yeah, exactly.
They don't give any fucks about your little toy belt
but,
or whatever.
But by the way, since you listened to the episode and I didn't, did he mention anything at all about Dana White's comments about that you're going to fight Thompson kind of thing?
I don't think he did. Other than, like, he said, hey...
Maybe
he just
skirted
kept,
around it?
Well, no, he just kept just saying, like, hey, I've never turned down a fight. Down a fight. So, like...
Like, don't get me wrong, I don't think he would say no.
Well,
to,
that's what
he's
saying.
Money,
he's like,
yeah,
he's like, this is what I'm asking for, but I don't turn down fights.
Because so like, what I think...
He'll take whatever fight
what
he gets,
I think is going to happen...
He's just trying to line shit
it's,
up.
It's kind of... It's not too far away, but I think he will fight Thompson first. And it's probably be, what, 205? Because that's how he'll get his money.
Probably.
So that's... It's a win-win for him.
Oh,
right?
UFC 205.
That's
like, why
sorry,
would they
yeah.
fight at 205 pounds?
But
that's
do,
so
do,
crazy.
Yeah. But do you know what I mean,
this
though?
Some Conor McGregor shit?
But do you know what I mean? Like, he gets his money because it's a huge fucking card, right?
I don't know if they would put... They would probably put them on, like, 206.
Where do you... Oh, yeah, where's that supposed to be?
I don't know.
No one said anything.
I don't know. But I'm just, that's what I'm saying, though, is, like... Because they're going to... That 205 is already so stacked with people.
Fuck, dude. They'll probably just make
because
him the Wonderboy main event.
They're looking to maybe
main,
put JJ... Unless they put JJ on a separate card that same weekend. Maybe they would put them on that.
Yeah. Either way, you already know he'll tell Dana, yes, I'll fight Wonderboy, but I need a certain percentage of a purse. Because I can't remember if it was on MMA Hours listening to it, but I think someone said that Woodley was requesting almost double the regular purse that he gets right now or cut.
I didn't hear that. I do know Woodley is campaigning for 205, though.
Yeah.
Like, he did say that on the podcast. He's like, I'm looking to fight on that New York card.
Because right now, if you were to make the New York card, who would be your main event? Would you do a JJ? No, because you can't. I mean, I love JJ and I love Karolina Kowalkiewicz, but they probably won't be able to sell main event with that, right?
Sorry, that weird break in our speech was thanks to the Blue Angels. They can go fuck themselves. Fucking military loves to display their goddamn dicks all over the sky so that it interrupts everything I record ever. It's the fucking best. Hey, you dumb fucks! It's the 20th century. 21st even. 22nd even. It's not the
22nd.
But my point being, the internet exists. Create a goddamn video game where you can fly some Blue Angel shit and stop being over my goddamn house all the time.
Yeah, run a simulator, please.
Jesus Christ, really? Really? We already know you're there. We hear you every year, and you're always fucking annoying as hell. All right, sorry. So now that I'm done shitting on the military, I'm not shitting on the military. I'm shitting on the military's funding. Well, let's go to something more positive.
Yes.
I forgot where I was.
We're talking about this basic Tyron Woodley and Wonderboy, and who's
right.
I asked you, who do you think would be the main event at 205? If you were to think, I'd tap your head right now. Obviously, I'm thinking at least a co-main, someone from New York, like a Chris Weidman.
I think you got to put a Chris Weidman. You got to put a Frankie Edgar.
You got to do a Weidman against Rockhold. That's probably going to happen.
That would be a good fight, yeah.
Because I know Rockhold says he wants to fight Anderson Silva.
Yeah, why the fuck would they not do that fight? I know. Yeah. Fuck him and his Anderson Silva.
Yeah, no. It's going to... Yeah.
All right, that was another fucking Blue Angel that can go eat a bag of dicks.
We were saying, about, you know, people from New York, you know. You could just think of Chris Weidman's camp. You know, what is it? I think it's Weidman... Longo now, actually. Or maybe it's Sarah Longo. So I don't know what
it
is.
I don't know. I don't
Who knows? But, you know, I think it was just like Aljamain Sterling, Alain Quinta, all those dudes out there, whoever the fuck's out there in Long
Most
Island.
Most of them.
Yeah.
You figure Frankie Edgar probably
And yeah,
gets
he has joint practices with Jersey guys. Like Edgar and all those guys, you know. I don't know about Mickey Gall, because I know he's a Jersey guy, too. I think he has his own
camp. Probably too soon after the Sage fight. Because is that... That's not on that card, right?
Wait, what? You mean the CM Punk fight? That's a 203.
Oh, you're right, Mickey Gall. Right. Yeah. Maybe. I don't know. It depends on how
that's... Okay, but okay, if we
if
brain...
If he fucking...
If,
like,
we, if we
if
brainstorm...
If he, like, Chris Cyborgs... Or, I mean, not Chris. If he Santos Cyborg Santos
oh,
big CM Punk, then yeah,
oh
he'll
God.
Get on 205.
All I gotta say is too soon.
Well,
he's recovered, so it's not too soon.
The good news is he probably won't roll a Pokeball.
Unofficial shout outs to Pokemon Go. Just kidding.
That's right. Shout out, Michael MVP, Michael Vitter Page.
Anyways, but yeah, if you think about it, I know they're asking even Conor McGregor, like, oh, do you think he'd be good to go for 205? Like, do you think they'd say, fuck it, let's roll with it, Aldo 2, let's go?
It depends on what he does.
Yeah.
Maybe.
If it's Aldo rematch, they have to, yeah.
He keeps shitting on the idea of fighting Aldo again.
Yeah, because I ask you, are you against a return to 145? He's like, maybe.
He's like, I already beat Aldo, and Aldo's the interim, so, like, you know. Like, no, bitch, we don't know. I don't know. I don't know.
Hey, unless they want to do it where he's like, fuck my fucking belt, which he probably never would. I'm sure he'd defend at least, maybe not. But I was going to say, hey, if he gets rid of his belt... Give Cruz his super fight. Fucking fight Aldo at 205. That'd be fucking sweet.
That would be dope. Really what I want to see is... they've been talking about putting JJ on there because there's a huge Polish community in Jersey and New York. So that'd be an interesting idea on it, too. Anyway,
yeah.
We're way off topic. We should get back to a couple podcasts.
So
we can crank out this one because I need another beer.
Yeah, I do, too, in a second. I was just going to mention real quick.
Well, while you're doing that, I wanted to mention Luke Thomas this week did a breakdown on Aldo Edgar from UFC 200.
Oh, yeah, it was that how did Aldo beat Edgar thing? Yeah.
He said he's watched it like 400 times since the, or like, actually, I think he said like a couple thousand times. Some crazy number that's not real.
Wouldn't be surprised.
Yeah, and he's like, I finally watched it enough times that I think I know what's going on. And he did an amazing breakdown on just the way... Aldo's able to constantly escape all of Edgar's entry attempts and just all of the crazy framing and timing that Aldo is able to do against Frankie, and Frankie, from what he described, only threw a couple different options the whole fight, and I think it seemed like he expected a lot more kicks, which I kind of did too. But it was just an interesting breakdown. I don't have a ton of details on it other than just Luke Thomas just going frame by frame on certain stuff and just saying, like, Aldo is the fucking best at takedown defense. Like,
he was great.
Dude,
that was an excellent display of skill, yeah.
Yeah, and the way Luke is able to break it down frame by frame is really dope. I recommend checking out the video version. I think it's up on YouTube.
Yeah, it's always on YouTube on MMA Fighting, SB Nation.
Yeah, of course. But if you SBN. Don't see it there, you can listen to it as well on his Luke Thomas podcast.
I know I have it on Spotify because I follow his thing, so it's always up. But it's probably on iTunes too.
Yeah, and you can just find it if you're any RSS feed for. He's on all the RSS.
What I was gonna say. Mentioning the how Aldo, you know how he was kind of being real. He was excellent with his stopping the entry takedowns and all that. I remember when McGregor was on MMA Hour, he was like, oh, you know, I've been studying the 145 division, you know, while I've been doing my thing, you know, making money, right? He was saying, oh, Aldo looks tentative. That's all he is. You know, he's scared. He's a point fighter. Whatever kind of bullshit he's trying to stir up, we get it. You know, it's just...
So unlike Hunter all he kept to stir up random bullshit. I know. Bullshit.
He kept talking about his whole 13-second knockout every fucking 5 seconds. But either way, but you know what? Well, when you fight someone like Frankie Edgar,
Like, so you're like, well, why would I want to do it again? That was the best that's ever going to work out for me. I can't get better than that. Why would I do it again?
Yeah, if I do a rematch, what do I do? I actually have to fight him. Oh, right. Shit.
It's going to be not nearly as fun as the 13 seconds that I barely fought him for the first time.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just gonna say credit to McGregor. He's lucky Aldo's not a wrestler, but still,
Aldo can wrestle fucking.
Of course he could. Yeah, but either way, once you say that rematch is inevitable, I think it has
Aldo's
to be.
Aldo's gotten takedowns on Frankie and shit. Like,
but don't you think that rematch is inevitable? They have to fight. They will fight at least once. There's no fucking.
Unless Conor just permanently bails from 145.
See, I think his pride's too big for that.
Well,
dude.
So here's the thing: is if he wins against Nate, he can bail from...
Oh, he will. No, yes, he was about to say that, too.
And go for the title.
This is why everyone listening, please root for Nate, which he'll probably...
I don't even think you have to root for Nate.
I mean, you don't have to. It's just
Nate
kinda...
being Nate is good for that shit.
Yeah.
But
as a fight fan, just hope Nate wins regardless, which, I mean, we'll get into it, but it's in his favor.
The only scary thing about Nate winning is, what the fuck did they do with Nate? Because
he'll probably... Would he demand a title fight or just money fight?
Well, that's what I don't know. Cause fuck. At that point...
Okay, let's interject real quick. Money fight. Fuck it. Nate Diaz wins again.
Dopest money fight.
Where does
Nate
he
Diaz?
Go? But who does he fight? And at what weight?
Well, so
let's brainstorm.
He always says he doesn't want the GSP fight because it's Nick's fight.
Yes. Okay, so that's out of the question. So what weight class? Would you say 155 or 170?
155, that's his weight class.
And who does he fight there? See, he has to fight a title contender, though. That's not a money fight, right? But who's a fucking money fight? Not Cerrone, too. You can't do that.
The dopest fight they could make would be Eddie Alvarez. Or, no, you know what the other one, though, is?
Because even Eddie Alvarez says he wants to win with these guys.
Well, so here's what I've heard is, I've heard Robbie Lawler... Because Nick doesn't want the Robbie Lawler fight.
Wait, can Robbie drop to 155?
No, at 170.
Oh, okay, yeah. I was going to say.
Nick
fuck.
Doesn't want Robbie Lawler fight again.
Oh, okay.
But...
I'd be down for that. That'd be kind of cool.
It'd be a dope fight. I think Nate would probably win that fight, too.
I mean, he could take punishment.
Only thing that's would be kind of the crazy part is Robbie's a really good wrestler.
Yeah.
But we haven't seen Robbie use his wrestling.
I honestly can't say the last time I remember him wrestling, except for a long ass time ago. So.
Yeah, so it should be.
But yeah, either way, matchup. If Nate wins, he has a shitload of options.
He has a lot of options.
He does.
I really want Nate Diaz, Eddie Alvarez. That would be the dopest fucking fight.
I was going to say, let's
that
interject.
That would be such a good fight.
Let's interject one more time. As far as that 155 division goes, the rumor I saw. Well, what's confirmed is Rafael Dos Anjos is fighting Tony Ferguson in Mexico City. That's going to be fucking great. UFC fighting in Mexico City. Yep. That's going to be awesome.
That means Khabib's probably getting a title
however,
shot, right?
Yeah, see, it either means he's getting a title shot or... Fuck, dude, I just saw something who he's fighting. Oh, I remember what the rumor is. The current rumor is Khabib is going to fight Edson Barboza.
Oh, I did hear Edson asking for that fight.
Yes. So that's the current rumor. So where does that leave Eddie? Eddie says he currently wants the winner of McGregor-Diaz.
I love that fight.
Why not?
Dude, that's the fight I want.
Because how would you even like...
What they come out to Nate Diaz with money.
Because like, I know Eddie's got his whole wrestling background too, besides his kind of just crazy power boxing.
Dope wrestling.
To 155, you can't count on McGregor because that's his natural weight. You know what I mean? So I feel like the exchanges would be interesting. It'd be really methodical and technical. So that'd be a fun fucking fight, dude. McGregor versus Alvarez for the 155 belt. Well, whatever you want to call it.
That's if McGregor gets past Diaz.
Yeah, but see, yeah, that one, yeah.
But like, so I'd love to see a Nate Diaz, Eddie Alvarez matchup for the title. I think that would be dope. But yeah, I don't know. These goddamn Blue Angels are goddamn killing me right now. So. Ironically, the Angels are killing me. So we are going to take a break. And when we come back, there won't be fucking plane noise in the background, hopefully. And should also, since it's only 9:20 at night, you fucks. And after that, we will get into... Oh, wait, we're listening to something on this segment. Heavy Hands Breakdown.
Yes.
So this is the Heavy Hands Breakdown Part 2, and then we are going to get into the UFC 200 Breakdown.
202.
That's, thank you.
202. Same thing.
Close. You didn't let me finish the 200 Breakdown and 2.
Yes.
Nailed it. All right. Edibles are not affecting me, and we will be back with a new beer and a new outlook. So, BRB, y'all.
And there's a moment in this fight where a switch flips. Nate Diaz feels that uppercut and immediately starts taunting Conor McGregor, starts walking him down and coming after him. And Conor McGregor has his last desperate punch. He cracks Nate with a big left hand because Nate has gotten a little too overconfident and Nate doesn't care. And that's basically the beginning of the end.
Yeah, so you can see in that series of exchanges right there, that Nate immediately, once he feels that uppercut, I know exactly the punch you're talking about.
Yep.
He immediately turns up the volume. So I went and counted strikes after that, and Nate had gone from throwing like 15 to 20, which is kind of his usual feeling you out, getting to know you kind of volume, to he throws 30 strikes in the minute after he feels that left hand. Then almost exactly a minute later is when he buzzes McGregor with that hard 1-2.
Yep.
And then in the 30 seconds after that, Nate throws 30 strikes.
Yeah.
What up, everybody? We are back. Oh, man. You missed a lot. We've been fighting the Blue Angels emotionally this entire time. We watched, like, a shitload of Nate Diaz fights. We watched, listened to some of the Heavy Hands podcast.
We watched an episode of that,
We watched some of the Get Down on Netflix.
Yeah, the new Netflix series, The Get Down. It's a cool show.
So, holy shit. You will eventually hear that the planes have not stopped. We gave up. So we're going to make this a quick rundown of these fights. We are not going to go over this first opening fight because I don't know the names of either one of these dudes.
Yeah, to be fair, Alberto Pereira and Martin Vettori. Sorry, we don't really know too much about you, but...
I got no idea. Hyungu Lim is fighting a guy named Mike Perry. I'm going to go with Hyungu Lim because he's going to fuck him up. A name that I'm not going to pronounce because I don't want to be a racist.
Guan Yu Ning.
Is fighting Marlon Vera.
Oh, that dude's from The Ultimate Fire, Latin America. Okay.
Yeah, I'm going to go with the guy from...
Yeah, Ultimate Fire. Marlon Vera's got some pretty good credentials.
Right. Colby the Cheese Covington.
Yeah, that's very, very applicable to that.
I forget who always says that. I think it might be...
The guy's kind of a stiff.
It might be co-main event. No, they just say it sounds... Colby Covington sounds like a delicious cheese.
Yeah, but that guy's also a cheese.
He's fighting Max Griffin, who I have no idea who that is.
So, Colby Covington via WrestleFuck.
Yeah, something like that. Neil Magny, Lorenz Larkin, I'm actually hyped about. So, let's take a look at that one. Also,
was Lorenz Larkin, his last fight was Jorge Masvidal, right? I think.
Lorenz Larkin's last fight. Yeah, I think you're right. Oh, no, don't need that. Yep, nailed it. That's
Jack. That was a close one. That's right. And the Neo Magny, yeah, dude, they should have called that shit early. He was destroying the shit, Lombard.
So the line right now, Neo Magny is -140. Lorenz Larkin, +120. I really like Neo Magny at -140.
Yeah, so taking Neo Magny on that one.
Well, Neo Magny's just been a beast lately, and he's been beating dudes that are really fucking tough. Lorenz Larkin is also super tough, but has trouble with dudes who can wrestle real well.
His big names, too.
Yeah, and Neil Magny's just really been showing the fuck up lately and beasting on dudes.
Yeah.
So, I just wouldn't bet against the gazelle, as Brendan Schaub would call him, Neil Magny. Alright, let's jump on to Honda Marcos. Just kidding. Ronda Marcos, Courtney Casey.
Yeah.
So I don't know much about Courtney Casey. Even though I've evidently seen her fight 1, 2, 3.
I know I saw Ronda Marcos beat someone. Fuck, who was it?
Ronda Marcos has beat a bunch of people.
Oh, it was Jocelyn Jones Leibarger. That's right. The also girl from Mesa College that we were advocating for.
Right. He also, has a win over Aislinn Daly, who is from Conor McGregor's Shirtbus Gym. She's actually been a beast in the
UFC. I would go with Ronda Marcos in this one.
She did really well in the Ultimate Fighter. I definitely think Ronda Marcos should have the huge edge in this.
Let's see. We got go by Sure Dogs, right? Because I know Simo's best fight odds are a little off, too.
Well, no.
I'm looking at the odds. I'm a dumbass.
Yeah. -130 for Ronda is not bad. I'll probably play that, too. I always get nervous playing WMMA fights because they're fucking sometimes not consistent like I think they would be. Speaking of which, coming to the next one, Raquel Pennington, who I still think beat Holly Holm, and who I still almost made a shitload of money on, fighting Elizabeth Phillips. This should be a dope fight. I'm a huge Rocky Pennington fan. She's just fantastic, always. She's cool as shit and always funny. Also, evidently, if you're on the underground at all, you'd know she's dating Tisha Torres, evidently. So that's pretty dope. Also, she beat up Betchkoya, so that's cool.
Oh, fuck, that's right.
I always enjoy. I think she was out, I want to say, because of an injury for a bit, but I could be wrong. Between September and April, I think. I could be wrong about that. Either that or somebody dropped out on her. And somebody else took the fight. Maybe that's what the Betch fight was. Anyway, Rocky's always fun. She always comes to scrap. She's tough as fucking nails. Actually, has super underrated clinch work. Elizabeth Phillips fought in 2015 against
Jess. She hasn't had too many fights in the past year, basically.
Now. Yeah, I always bet against inactivity, especially when it's Rocky Pennington, who's a motherfucking beast. So,
Go with Pennington for sure. And then I think you're looking for Artem Lobov next, right?
You're right. I did skip that one.
No, that's not saying. I know.
Trying to pretend Artem Lobov wasn't a person.
No. Yeah, the best fight odds listing is accurate with the shirt on.
I get what you mean.
So we got Artem Lobov from Conor McGregor's team, Straight Blast Gym, versus Chris Avila.
That's right.
From Nate Diaz's.
11-12 is Artem Lobov.
So, yeah, he's called the Russian Hammer, also known as what? The Body? I don't know, someone called the Torso.
Is that a thing? He has short-ass arms,
that's why.
Oh my God, can we just call him Russian Pitbull?
This is standard.
I mean, I fucking everyone's name everywhere. Why not? He's not even Russian, but I just enjoy it.
No, he is Russian.
Really?
Yeah, dude. He just moved to Ireland from Russia.
Oh.
Yeah. He's super Russian.
Well, yeah, I don't enjoy Artem Lobov. He is super
Everything's
sloppy.
Nice and flowy, Artem.
Flowy as in I'm just going to fucking Hail Mary everything I do, and we'll see how this goes.
And if someone takes me to the ground, I panic.
Yep. Oh, panic is underrating what he does.
So, and on that note, I'm going with Chris Sevilla.
Yeah, I'm going off with Chris Sevilla off straight training partners alone, because I think Artem doesn't have the training partner quality, nor the, I don't know, not head trauma.
Yeah, I remember I saw, too, I think I read, like, oh, although Artem has a 2-inch height advantage, I think he has something fucking stupid, like a 7-inch reach disadvantage. Something yeah. really terrible.
He's like a little Dennis Seaver out there.
He's literally a T-Rex.
Yeah, he's like a fire hydrant.
Yeah. that sounds better.
Yeah, it's good.
Jesus Christ.
I don't know. I like the idea of the fight, I just don't care. Cody Garbrandt.
This is gonna shape up the bantamweight division in one or two ways. If Cody No Love Garbrandt from Team Alpha Male or Fail, whatever your preference is, Cody Garbrandt will either vie for a title shot against Dominic Cruz, but in my collective opinion, I think he'll have to go through TJ Dillashaw, who really deserves.
Also, shout out to the Blue Angels.
Yes, of course, in the background. But do you see where I'm getting at, brother? Yeah, I mean, don't you think he's going to have to go through Dillashaw? Like, they're not going to get... There's no way to get this dude an outright title shot. I mean, okay, like, we can get off the fact he probably can do more pay-per-view draws than Dillashaw, because Dillashaw doesn't like to talk, but...
If he, like, starches Mizugaki, like, the way Dominic Cruz did, yeah, he gets one. Yeah. But it has to be, like, basically the same way.
Yeah.
If he goes anywhere past around with Mizugaki... Or doesn't just murder him in a way that looks super highlight reel worthy. I don't see them throwing him in there immediately. Especially with Dom lobbying so hard for a bigger fight like a dude like Jose or somebody.
Or even Conor, yeah. So yeah, so what do you think in this fight? Well, I feel like Cody knockout round three later. They're going to separate... Mizugaki's gonna keep his distance. I think like Cody's gonna have to use his wrestling for once, man.
That's why I think Cody's gonna take it to the decision.
Decision, yeah, that's fair too.
Yeah, Mizugaki's tough. He's really hard to finish. I see Cody being super cautious of throwing too hard for getting taken down. And I think he's gonna just stay safe and use his wrestling offensively. There's going to be a lot of clinch work, a lot of, like, just weird takedowns, and, I don't know. I'm not super confident either way. I'm not necessarily confident Cody Garbrandt isn't going to get taken down by Mizugaki.
By the way, real quick, go to Best Fight Odds. This is one of the fights I was telling you in favor of Mizugaki, if you're a betting man, that is. I believe if you bet on Mizugaki by TKO KO, it's pretty goddamn insane. Okay, see, it went down a little bit, but yeah, that's...
14-20.
Wow.
But that's also because Mizugaki never
yes, I get that, but you know what I mean.
Yeah.
Because what's him by decision?
Mizugaki by decision...
665.
Huh? Yep. Yeah, that's not terrible. I don't know. I see Cody probably getting top position more often if there is wrestling exchanges or just staying on the outside and pumping enough jabs at him to kind of take it Holly Holm style.
Yeah.
Again, I don't know. A lot of these fights, well, first off, I should say the edibles killing me. So I'm exhausted already. But also, a lot of these fights are just good matchups that I could see going either way. I don't really have strong feelings about them one way or the other. Especially this one and the next one, which has a dude I've never heard of.
So Tim Means versus Saba Hamasi?
Sure.
Something like that?
Who the fuck is the guy that's not called Tim Means?
Yeah, who's Saba Hamasi, an Egyptian? I don't know. The Punisher.
Well, his last fight was in Titan. So that's a sign. I also fought in Bellator back in the day. Not fought any dudes I'm recognizing towards the top. Not a lot of experience. Tim Means, the Dirty Bird, ironic nickname now, since he did just get off suspension.
Oh, how wonderful.
Lost to Matt Brown via sub. Also has a win over John Howard, where he knocked him the fuck out. Tim Means is a beast. He's tough as nails. I don't know what he's going to look like coming back. Time off is always tough, but time off on top of USADA stuff makes it double tough. But against this...
Then again, he's fighting some guy named The Punisher. Jesus Christ.
That's kind of why, yeah. So, I'm obviously leaning Tim Means.
Yeah. Tim Means. You got it. Tim Means.
I lean towards Tim Means. But I... Yeah, I don't know. It always makes me nervous when dudes are...
Donald Cowboy Cerrone versus Rick Story, which might be one of the best fights of the night overall.
Yeah, you would think. It could go one of two ways. Either it's going to be both of them piecing the fuck up out of each other on the feet, or it's going to be Donald Cerrone put on his back the entire fucking fight and just getting punched in the head a lot on the ground.
Yeah.
I'm interested to see who the ref's going to be on this. So if it's going to be like John McCarthy or somebody, it might be more interesting than if it's like a Herb Dean or a Gotti.
I forgot. Rick Story beat someone. Who the fuck did he just beat?
Rick Story. Coming off wins off of Tarek Safin, Gunnar Nelson, and some other dude named Teixeira.
Gunnar Nelson, okay.
Yep. Whereas, of course, Cerrone come off wins over Cowboy Oliveira and Patrick Cote. The Patrick Cote one was super impressive.
That's where I'm leaning towards Cowboy. Probably via decision, though. I feel like they're going to go the three rounds, right?
It's going to be... I definitely see it going decision. It's going to be really tough. I don't know. I kind of just keep seeing Rick Story.
Oh, no, because Rick Story's the bigger guy, right?
He's a natural 170, and he gets way down to get to that. Yeah. He's a huge dude, and he's a tough wrestler, which Donald has good wrestling defense, but not the best wrestling defense. So what's the line on this right now?
Probably Cerrone minus 130, something like that. Oh, wow, 165.
Yeah. Plus 140 on Rick Story isn't terrible. How about Rick Story by decision? Rick Story by decision is plus 239, and the line is going down because people are figuring out what the fuck is good. I might put a unit or so on Rick Story by decision. So I kind of like the look of that. But overall, I think that's going to be a super scrappy fight. And I'm interested to see whose game plan kind of takes over in that one. Let's see. So, Anthony Johnson, Glover Teixeira. This is another really interesting matchup. I heard this fight compared to... Who was it? Glover versus OSP.
Oh, that's right. Didn't Glover beat him by submission?
Yeah, except they said Anthony Johnson obviously is way more explosive and way more dynamic.
Yeah, definitely, that's a fact.
And, man, Anthony Johnson, like, luckily Glover does an eye poke, because that's the number one way Anthony Johnson wins a fight, is if you eye poke him, he kills you.
Well, yeah, just look at the Gustafson example, right?
I heard Jordan Breen literally said that on Sherdog, like, maybe a day or two before that happened. He's like... If he gets eye poked one time, that shit's gonna be the end of the fight. He's just gonna come after him and he's gonna murder him like he does in every fight, and then it just perfectly happened like that. It's pretty good. And he did that ever since he got that injury to his eye where he had to have surgery and all that.
Oh yeah, that's right.
Which makes sense. And he's fighting Glover Teixeira, obviously out of whatever gym, what's his face, trains out of John Hackelman and the Iceman, Chuck Liddell, and all those guys. Tough dude. Just got went over Rashad Evans recently, as well as Pat Cummings and OSP. This is kind of a story of who's going to be able to out-wrestle the other one as much as they are strikers. Because both of them are so fucking tough and they hit so fucking hard. I don't know. I think a lot of it's going to come down to who shoots first and do they get the takedown.
I feel like either way, I mean, I can see a decision, but yeah, like you're saying, they hit so hard, man. If you got to say who's going to knock out who, I got to go with Rumble just because he's probably got more pop in his punch.
I agree, but
Glover's probably got better boxing, right,
overall? Well, he does, and I don't know about that, but he has better he has a really, really strong chin, and he has pretty good gas tank for how big he is.
Fuck, then. Maybe we just, what are the odds? Maybe we go with Glover, man. Via what?
I don't know. No,
split decision?
I would say Anthony Johnson's probably the smart pick, but I do like Glover. What is he? +160 something. It sounds about right. Whereas Anthony Johnson's around -200 and -195. I do like... Anthony Johnson is a smart pick in this fight, but I think Glover is definitely super game and... If a really in shape and on point Glover Teixeira shows up to that fight, Anthony Johnson could be in a lot of trouble.
Yeah, that'll be interesting to see for sure.
And then Nate Diaz, Conor McGregor. I'm not going to be surprised again, motherfuckers.
Yeah, no, I agree 100%. I fully expect Nate Diaz to take this. My prediction is Nate Diaz via submission. TKO wouldn't surprise me, but I expect submission probably round three.
Middle
of the fight.
I think it's going to be TKO or knockout by Nate. I don't know when, probably late. I'm trying to see lines for...
Right, round four.
Decision. McGregor. Diaz, TKO, +1,000? Oh, in round one. Ooh, Diaz, TKO, in round one is +1,000. That's ridiculous, but kind of cool. Let's see. I can't read this from this far. Anyway, I really like Diaz. I like Diaz to stop him probably by ground and pound or on the feet. I think he's just going to be able to box Conor's face off, honestly. I think Conor's going to try and come up with some kicking shit, and Nate's going to blast him with a super straight left, and Conor's going to freak the fuck out again. And
he's going to shoot.
I don't even think he's going to shoot this time. I think he's going to throw some like weird spinning bullshit, and he's going to get boxed the fuck up.
Yeah.
And I think Nate's going to literally elect to pound him out instead of choking him out this time intentionally. And I don't know. I just see Nate stopping Conor. I don't see Conor getting out of this one.
Yeah, the only way Conor wins is if he storms in the first round and catches him with some, I don't know.
First or second. Like, unless he catches him with something crazy, which is possible. Conor hits hard, but... Nate's super fucking durable and he's super accurate, and I just don't see Conor being able to put anything together on him in any kind of significant way. But more than anything, I'm just interested to see what strategies both these dudes take coming into this fight, because it's going to say a lot about how smart both those dudes are, which everybody already kind of knows. They're both really bright fighters, so... I'm just psyched to see how all this plays out, and I think it's going to be a great fucking card overall. Anything else you wanted to discuss or go over in more particular details?
I got nothing right now, man.
Perfect. Me neither, because I am high as shit off that fucking popcorn edible. I can barely open my fucking eyes. My head is so goddamn heavy, and this Oktoberfest from Left Hand Brewing is fucking my world up. So we're gonna wrap it here because I have work in the morning, but I am hyped for this card. It's gonna be fantastic, and we will definitely do a recap It might be a little bit late next week. We'll see, because Chris is actually leaving for the Netherlands on Wednesday. Yeah. So he will be out of the country, and we will be doing this over Skype going forward, which should be interesting. So bear with us on our audio quality and release schedule here shortly. But it should be a lot of fun. We're going to get Chris to ask people who Bas Rutten is while he's in the Netherlands.
Pretty much.
Like, do you know Bas Rutten? Are you related to Bas Rutten?
Just all they ever even go beyond that. If someone says, yes, I know Bas Rutten, I'm like, all right, do you know Stefan Struve? Do you know Alistair Overeem? And if they know those two too, then it's a conversation.
It's going to be some great reporting that we're going to have for you. So look for
I'll be on the European front.
That's right. That's right. He'll have a bike and a joint ready to go.
Pretty much.
All right. So we're going to wrap this one up. But if you have any questions or anything, email us chris@thesoundofviolence.com. Hit up the website, thesoundofviolence.com. We got articles and stuff up there, as well as all of our back podcasts. Hopefully we are going to be up on iTunes and all that shit soon, because we are still lagging like a bunch of motherfuckers. So look for all that. And until next time, go do some dumb decadent, everybody. We out.
Later. See you.